companion for animals who raised this question about the Islamic slaughtering of animals. And he said that by slitting the animal's throat is extremely painful for the animal and barbaric. So he maintained that the animal should be stunned before slaughtering, and it will be less painful if you do this, and more human. So what is your comment on this?
I do not accept this premise at all. In fact, sometimes members of such organizations came to meet me during my Krishna sessions. They were very strong advocates for the animals and the pain the humans caused them. And when I explained the thing to them, they agreed without exception that the Islamic system is the correct one. You see, when you stun an animal, the situation of his brain, the animal's brain, is similar to a person who is suffering from, you know, some internal torture, mental or physical, because of cancer, etc., and who is heavily doped and put under the influence of, say, some opiate. Now, we do not know what animal feels, but we know what such people feel. When they return to consciousness, they always tell that although they could not express their feeling of great pain and suffering, but deep inside, during that so-called sleep, they were so restless that the brain was constantly suffering. Now, this is the experience of the people who can come back and tell. Animals can never return to tell what they felt. But their mental state under stunning blow is very similar to that caused by opiates to humans. This is, in the view of this human experience, we can positively reject the claim that by stunning you you remove all possibilities of animal suffering. It's not true. The only way the brain can be really stunned without feeling anything is by sharply cutting the blood supply to the brain. While in the state of this, this drugged state, neither the blood supply of animals is cut off nor that of humans is cut off. So it is the blood supply constantly reaching the brain cells which keeps them alive and capable of feeling either pleasure or suffering. But if the blood supply is cut off, they immediately die. No suffering can ever be felt. No pleasure can ever be felt. So now look at the Islamic system. Ahzur sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised that the animal should be slaughtered at throat hair and with a very sharp instrument, so that just one, pass at the throat immediately severs the jugular vein or artery, and the blood supply to the brain is removed altogether suddenly. The prick that the animal will suffer from would be just that sharp passing movement. And maybe before he can suffer, the blood supply would be cut off anyway. So this is the true position. And as I've told you, when I explained it in so many words to the advocates of animal suffering, etc., they were compelled to agree. They were, had no way out, but they had to agree that this is the correct system and no better system can be devised. Now, you should remember that Ahmad strictly forbade to cut off animals before doing this to them. People before in Arabia used to even slice pieces of animals while they were still alive. That was cruel. So such cruelty is forbidden by Rasulullah in all forms. The only way is this, which I have just described to you. Right?
Thank you.
A few nights ago, there was a program on television about Senegal. They show in that program some Muslims. So what they doing? They are doing some sort of circumcision for small
what?
Girls.
Circumcision.
For small girls. And then before they get mama,
girls?
They, yeah, very small girls.
Oh, no.
2-3 years.
It's not a question of small or big. It's horrible. It's not Islamic at all.
But one gentleman, he was sitting and with open Holy Quran in front of him, and he explained that is said so in Holy Quran.
No. I don't know which Holy Quran he was holding in his hand.
Yeah.
He was a big liar. There is not the slightest indication in the Holy Quran that ladies should be circumcised. Absolutely out of question. Nor were they circumcised before. The reference is given to Abraham and his sunnah, which should be followed by Muslims. But in that sunnah, you don't find any mention of ladies being circumcised, or girls for that matter. This is an African invention, and pagan invention for that matter, which also found its way into Islam, Muslims of that area. And the reason for that circumcision is only to offer a girl to a chief or a big person with the guarantee that this girl has not have had any illicit relationship with any man. Because during this circumcision, they create a round circle of stiff muscles which are sewn together, with the result that penetration is not possible anywhere. That is why, when they are offered to big chiefs by the people or the tribe, the chief knows that this girl has not been used before. So this is the cruel practice and meaningless practice for that matter. So Islam strongly condemns such meaningful practices. There is no such mention in the Holy Quran. You see, to my knowledge, the word khatna, which means circumcision, is not even mentioned in the Quran anywhere. So that's why I said only Sunnah Ibrahim is mentioned, and because we know it was one of the Sunnahs of Abraham, so we accept this as a tradition for men. So that man was a big rascal, was holding the Quran before him and reading things which were not even mentioned in the Quran.
So it's very, very known in Germany as well.
Yes.
They everywhere make articles that in Islam girls get cut.
This is wrong.
It's very...
They do it willfully, just to blemish Islam for something Islam has never preached.
Cool.
We should write articles, counter-articles, telling them,
yes.
Right? He's a big rascal as well.
Sorry, sir?
As such, he's a big rascal.
Rascal means?
A wanton person, a very evil man.
Ah.
Now Turkey, at last.
Again, from Barber Han, Turkey. A generalization
it's
might
always
be
him.
Yes.
It is always him, eh? Never anyone else.
No.
Huh? All right, come on. I don't object against him asking questions. He asks good questions. Okay, please.
A generalization might be made about the national character of the people. For example, the British are often seen as a romantic people. In this light, could Huzur give his opinion on the national character of the Turks?
Okay, the national character of the Turkish people is that they are very rigid in certain attitudes. They are rigid in their national traditions of being a free people. And they would never accept being enslaved by any foreign country. This is one of the most prominent characters of the Turkish people. They will do anything, offer every sacrifice, but they must remain free, not under the yoke of any foreign rule. Do you agree with this character?
Correct.
Secondly. Secondly, they love Islam, but they do not practice it. They love Islam in generality, but little do they care for Islamic values in daily life and daily practices. Those who do practice Islam among them are very rigid, so strict that nothing of Islam is left within the stiff outside, within their empty. So those who do not practice Islam with such rigidity, they turn to Sufism. And under the opiate of Sufism, they can do anything which they like, but Islam. So it's a strange contradiction in Turkish life. Some people are left with only utensils, which should have been filled with the spirit of Islam. Some people try to keep the spirit of Islam without utensils, so they cannot. So this, in my opinion, is the overall character of the Turkish people. Look at this tree. What do you find incongruent in this? Something wrong, something, you know, is not you, which your eyes can, which you should really accept. What is wrong?
Some bees they hang upside down.
What?
Some birds they hang upside down.
No, that's in the nature of birds, they always do this. So. Bade, what's your opinion?
Have none.
It's very evident. It's the same tree with same leaves, but where's all the different fruits you find on different trees? You see, the pear, the apples,
flowers.
The apricots, the this and that, oranges, and if the person had created different leaves on different branches, then we could understand that the branches belong to different trees. But you can't have the same leaves indicating the same tree, yet having different fruits. See?
Yeah.
So
an imaginary tree.
What?
It's an imaginary tree.
Imagination.
Imaginary tree. But I can't imagine such incongruities in nature.
Shajaratul Khurd.
I think I should tell the person, she's a great artist who made this to bring about certain changes and add some new branches with different leaves, and those leaves should indicate the fruits in the branches there. Right? Masalat is it.
Yes.